Okay. We're starting Colossians 2 with our prop once again.
Oh. Why don't you start with it? You remember that?
Yeah, Adam will remember.
So Adam remembers. You remember the shtick? Whenever we say fullness, we're accenting the fullness. So, Colossians 2. Once again, our theme is fullness. Title, The Fullness in Christ. Now, in this chapter, we have Paul presuming that those Colossians and those Laodiceans, whom he has not met, it's likely he hasn't met either of them, that they are knowing God to some extent, just as all humans are knowing God to some extent, as Paul reminded us in Romans, and he reminded us in the first chapter of Colossians. But more specifically, he's presuming that those kooky Colossians are largely knowing that Christ is God in verse 2. Remember, Christ is God. And those, he's presuming this because Pappy told him as much, right? Pappy revealed that truth to those Colossians. Yet Paul still wanted to emphasize that. He wanted to reinforce that Christ is God to them. And he grammatically indicates that in verse 3, some way. To that effect, the very best manuscripts we have for these verses, which are P46 of Vaticanus, some papyrus manuscripts that were probably 2nd century, they show no words at all between God and Christ. Now, in your NIV translation, you do have words between God and Christ. Your NIV sticks the word namely between God and Christ. God, namely Christ. Well, actually, you can stick them right together and do without the namely part. And this indicates that there's a very, very close association between God and Christ. When you stick those words right together, there. That's called an apposition. People who play with grammar, they call it an apposition. And you can see that picture there where the words are jammed right together. You can see the overbar on God and then the overbar on Christ. And they're squished right together. There's nothing in between those words. And this is much to Jehovah Witness dismay. Why? Because they don't believe that Christ is God. They believe that is a blasphemy, associating Christ with God. They don't believe in the Trinity. But they believe that Christ is an archangel, named Michael. You might see him in the Bible now and again. And they will try to convince you that Christ is an archangel. Blah, blah. Anyways, Paul then speaks of those Colossians as knowing Christ in a foundational way, very foundational way. In a way as foundational as the roots are to a tree. You see that in verse 7, the roots. And he relays that those Colossians were firm in the faith. Decent. They were firm in the faith. And they were disciplined. Cool. Seems that Pappy taught his homies pretty well, after all. Now, however, it also seems that they had some undisciplined philosophies. Some philosophies lacking any roots. Some dopey philosophies from Socrates and Plato, probably. And dopey philosophies from Roman and Greek myths, probably. And those philosophies are just as dopey as our present-day philosophies like evolution and equality. We are just as dope. You know, we're no worse than they are. We're no better than they are, rather. And those philosophies are devoid of wisdom, as Paul goes on to say. They're devoid of wisdom. They are philosophies devoid of knowledge. Does anybody know what the definition of wisdom is? No? Yes, Tim. It's the way you apply your knowledge. Yeah, that's wisdom. So, now, Paul is not saying that all philosophies are dopey in verse 8. Grammatically speaking, to translate the Greek properly, he's not saying that all philosophies are dopey. After all, there are some philosophies that are not dopey. Philosophies such as the philosophy of redemption. Yay, whoa. But he is saying that those other philosophies are hollow and deceptive. They're going to deceive you. And that they have no redemptive power and authority, he says in verse 10. He was saying that those philosophies are a virtual reality without worth, basically, in verse 17. And those philosophies are basically just an excuse for people to justify their lack of discipline. Just to give you a little more current knowledge on philosophy, people have been wrestling with this for millennia. Philosophy. Oh, this knowledge that is supposedly wise. You would do well to see that philosophy is almost completely useless. Basically useless. Philosophy is all very often called a handmaid into theology. Ooh, as if it helps theology in some way. It doesn't. It helps theology in no way whatsoever. The handmaiden of philosophy is largely handcuffed and shackled. It couldn't change a diaper if it wanted to. Philosophy is virtually useless. And this is becoming more apparent to us all the time. All the time. There's a professor at Westminster Seminary, brilliant professor at Westminster Seminary, who recently said, the philosophy of the past 4,000 years has been an abysmal failure. And it's hard to get more critical than that about philosophy. I am because I think. No, it's not brilliant at all. There's also another brilliant scholar named John Frame who said basically the same thing in a huge book that he's just released. Book was just published with rave reviews by many brilliant people. And basically this review of the philosophy of the past 4,000 years says the same thing. Philosophy is totally useless. And that textbook promises to be the go-to book in not going to philosophy. Haha. And Paul insists that Christ is full. Just as Paul insisted that the gospel is a full philosophy. And that Christ is a full reality and deity. So full that there are no other gods nor goddesses. There are no other titans or titanesses. There are no personified deities. There should be no personified concepts either. Such as Cupid and Mother Earth. That's silly. Yet it seems that a lot of those Colossians were humored by those fantasies. They were humored to the point of worshiping those fantasies, and they were losing their fullness in Christ as a result. Yeah. They were losing their lives as well, it seems, but more on that later. But the faithful homies were not losing their salvation, however. They were not losing their salvation, even if at some weak moment they may have put their faith in the weak philosophy of circumcision, as some confused Colossians were being compelled to do by the cutting-edge group we kindly call the Cutters. Yet, this was a cutting criticism that Paul briefly alludes to again. He admonishes those Colossians with the gospel again, telling them how they are to repent of their sins and believe in God who made you alive with Christ. And that is a belief that will negate, that will neutralize any unfaithful cutting which may have occurred in their unbelieving past. And this is a belief in the Christ who disarmed the alleged powers and authorities, we see in verse 15, who disarmed the power of death itself, who gravely embarrassed the Jewish and Gentile authorities, the authorities who put him to death. And here, Paul is probably more critical of the Jewish authorities again, as usual, criticizing those of the circumcision category. He is criticizing those who are obsessive about what you eat or drink, who are obsessive about how many religious festivals that you attend. Remember, there was three that they had to attend. He mentions the category of how you honor those festivals. Burnt offerings, he mentions, which is something they had to do every new moon, which is every month, in verse 16. However, there was another category there that Paul introduces, which was a tipping point for a man that I know, and that is the category of the worship of angels in verse 18. And that is a category that is not just some ancient mysticism from way back then, but it is also a category that exists in many churches today as well. And it was responsible for that man leaving his previous church. And the history on that was that there was a large framed picture of an angel that was donated to that man's church by a funeral home. And it was a picture inspired by a cloud, I guess. And that picture was gratefully received and introduced to the congregation in a church worship service. And that picture was posted in a prominent position in the church to give the congregation some obscure heavenly hope. We see that picture on the next page. To which that man affixed the verse of Colossians 2:18 underneath that picture. And that verse was not received nearly as well as the picture was. And that man was questioned on his actions. And after considerable discussion, that church decided to consider that picture as a mere icon rather than an object of worship. Just an innocuous, innocent icon. And they rejected that man's complaint against that icon, and he rejected that church. Now, whether that church was actually worshiping that angel or not is beside the point. That angel was still an idol. That angel was still a likeness of what is in heaven above, if you remember your Ten Commandments. It was an idol given an overly prominent position, just as angel pendants and tattoos are overly prominent and idolatrous. And those idols should be a tipping point for you. In the same way, that angelic category that Paul mentioned should be a tipping point for Roman Catholics. A tipping point since the Pope recently tweeted for the help of St. Michael the Archangel in defending us from the snares of the devil. As if the help of Christ is not defense enough. And this should be a tipping point for Jehovah's Witnesses as well. They should reject their church since they give St. Michael the credit for salvation. As the Lord was angry when he said, "I will not give my glory to another." He said that in Isaiah. "For I am a jealous God." Remember that one. And Christ is not an archangel. Once again, Christ is the fullness of God, and angels are... Even the archangel Michael is... An archangel who, legend has it, saved Colossae, say, from a flood around that time. The legend has it that this archangel caused lightning to split a rock, the rock split open, and that rock drank the flood coming towards the city of Colossae. So they granted, oh yeah, St. Michael saved us. Or Angel Michael, no. This was a salvation that was attributed to an angel prior to this letter to the Colossians. And they erected a statue, and this may have been in regard to that. And this was a very fleeting salvation, it seems, because Colossae was devastated soon after with an earthquake, which took the angel down to the statue. Yeah. So, this was a fleeting salvation for those Colossians who loved to whip themselves, those Colossians who loved to starve themselves, who loved to deny their bodily desires, those ascetics, we're told, who thought that rules would preserve their deprived bodies. So they followed those rules religiously. Which leads us to the final category of this chapter. Rules. Human rules, like do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. Rules that can apply to many, many things. Things like drugs, alcohol, and porn. Paul is talking about how those man-made rules lack any value against such things in verse 23. Any value. He's talking about how those rules do not restrain sensual indulgence, he says, insisting that those man-made rules will not preserve your body whatsoever. And that biblical truth is validated by our current results of just say no programs, DARE programs, programs that are largely ineffective against drugs. And as we see in Canada, we're seeing increased drug usage and legalization in the future instead. However, don't be getting the idea that Paul is opposed to man-made rules there, or even opposed to rules, as the latest pope seems to be opposed to certain rules in his latest guideline called the Joy of Love. However, if programs and rules don't restrain sensual indulgence, then what does? There's our dilemma. What does? And we're going to get into that dilemma next week. Colossians 3. We will address the simple solution to that next chapter. And it's going to be great. Now let's pray. Now, Father, thank you once again for showing us that the fullness is in you, and we are to follow you and you only, for you are the answer to our dilemma. Amen.